Hello friends, in this episode of our discussion on phase equilibrium, we are seeing liquid-liquid systems. You might have encountered several liquid-liquid systems like alcohol and water, phenol and water, and mercury in water. Considering the three, the first one, alcohol and water, the two liquids are completely miscible. That means the two liquids become a single phase, a homogeneous solution at any temperature and composition, and such systems are called miscible liquids. On the other hand, coming to phenol and water system, coming here, you can see that phenol and water are not completely miscible. They are not forming a single phase at all temperatures and composition. Only at certain composition and temperature you get single phase from these two liquids, and such systems which are miscible at only at certain proportions and certain temperature are called partially miscible systems. And the third one, coming to mercury water system, they are immiscible. That means at any composition and temperature they are not miscible. They form two separate phases, two separate layers in your vessel. But remember, the perfectly miscible system is not real. That is an ideal case. Even if I see mercury is immiscible in water, you can see some amount, very very small fraction of mercury in the water phase. Okay, so this is about the three kinds of liquid systems or binary liquid systems based on their miscibility. And let's consider now partially miscible liquids like phenol and water. If you take phenol and water, you have two different phases like this. The phenol form the bottom layer and water on the upper layer. But if you heat the system, you can see that after a while, as you increase the temperature, the two phases become miscible and you get only single phase in your test tube. And if you cool it down, gradually with decrease in temperature, you can see the separation of two phases, and at room temperature clearly the phenol phase and water phases are separately visible. And that means the miscibility is temperature dependent, and that temperature dependence is given through miscibility temperature. That means at the given composition, the temperature above which the two liquids become miscible, the two phases become single one. And critical solution temperature is that temperature above or below which, dependent on the nature of the two liquids, you can have above the CST or below the CST, the two liquids become homogeneously mixing, that is the two phases mixing into single phase. And that characteristic temperature which gives the miscibility of the two liquids at any composition is given by critical solution temperature. And based on critical solution temperature, you can have two systems. The first one, like in aniline and water, you can see that at this temperature, above this temperature of 168, the two liquids become completely miscible. You have only one phase. But below this temperature, selected compositions at least are forming two separate layers. So, critical solution temperature or upper critical solution temperature is the temperature above which any composition of the two liquids become completely miscible. On the other hand, the system with lower critical solution temperature, at room temperature, for example, triethylamine and water form two separate layers, two separate phases. But if you cool it down somewhere around 19 degrees centigrade, the two liquids become miscible at any composition. So, irrespective of the composition, at and below 19 degrees, the two liquids, the triethylamine and water, are completely miscible, forming only one phase. And now you've got a third type of liquids like nicotine and water. If you have the system of nicotine and water, you can see there, above 61 degrees centigrade and below 208 degrees centigrade, within this temperature range, the liquids become completely miscible. And below the lower temperature, that is 61 degrees centigrade, and above the upper temperature, that is 208 degrees centigrade, they are immiscible liquids forming two separate layers, two separate phases. That's about the critical solution temperature, upper, lower, and there are some systems having both upper and lower values for CST. A And now let's check what happens if you have got a system of two immiscible liquids and you are putting some solutes into it. Whether the solutes go and dissolve into the two liquids equally or not. No, the solutes get distributed into the two liquids in different fractions, different amount. And that distribution is given through a law called Nernst distribution law, which states that the ratio of concentrations of the solute in the two immiscible liquids is the same at the given temperature. That means if you have got the solute concentration C1 in the first phase and C2 in the second phase, and those two phases that are in equilibrium, at that condition you can say that the ratio between the two concentrations C1 and C2 is a constant at the given temperature, and that constant Kd is called distribution coefficient. Now let's see how the law is reached. Considering the chemical potential of the solute in the first phase A, this can be written in terms of the standard chemical potential of the solute in the first phase and the activity of the solute in the phase A. And similarly, this chemical potential of the solute in the phase B is given in terms of the standard chemical potential in B and the activity of the solute in B. And at equilibrium, the two chemical potentials are the same, and by equating and rearranging this equation, you reach the ratio of the activities of the solute in two liquids will be a constant. And for dilute solutions, you can replace this activity in terms of concentrations, because the activity coefficient is unity over there. For dilute solutions, we reach this equation, that is, the ratio of concentrations in the two phases is a constant, and that constant we called the distribution coefficient. And the value of Kd, this ratio, is valid for immiscible solvent. The two system of solvent should be immiscible, and you have the solute forming dilute solution in the two phases. And the Kd values depend on temperature, the nature of solvents and solute, but not on the amount of solvent or solute. And here are some applications of Nernst distribution law on solvent extraction, on the principle behind partition chromatography, drug release systems, and the solubilized systems like micellase or reverse micellase. Okay, with that, we are now closing our discussion on phase equilibria here. Atkins and McCurry are my favorite authors, and I'm looking forward for your feedback on the series of discussion. Thank you.